Welcome back to another episode of Beyond the Game with Hal. Today I'm thrilled to welcome former NFL linebacker Spencer Paysinger. Spencer is known for his days in the NFL and winning a Super Bowl with the New York Giants, and after becoming the writer for an all-hit American TV show series, All American. All American is now one of the top sports reality TV shows, and Spencer Paysinger has made a name for himself in the NFL, but also after his career. You won't want to miss this episode as we go well beyond the game with Spencer Paysinger.
When you were in high school, obviously going to college, getting recruited, when did it kind of click in your brain that you thought you were going to get recruited to play college football?
It was interesting. The first time I ever had any type of recruitment energy, it was my junior year of high school. I wasn't really like being looked at in any first couple games of the season, but one of my breakout games, I had maybe like 100 plus yards and maybe 2 touchdowns. And that following night or that following day, me and my uncle had flew up to University of Cal Berkeley to watch Berkeley play UCLA. So my uncle was well connected in the college sports space. He was my high school football coach. And the receivers coach for UCLA, I think his name was Dino Babers back then. They knew each other and I was kind of off to the side and I heard him go, "Who's this kid last name Paysinger like yours that was balling out? I saw it in the newspaper." And my uncle like looked over at me. He's like, "Oh yeah, that's Spencer. He's a junior." And he looked at me to tell the receiver coach, kind of sized me up. I was probably like 6'2 at this point. And he's like, "Tell him he'll be hearing from us." So UCLA was actually the first school that started sending me things after that initial interaction.
Right. And you said you were getting recruited to play wide receiver and then you played defense. How did that?
Yeah. So I was in high school, I was, you know, all CIF. So I was like kind of like all state, all division.
Yeah.
League MVP, just the league's like best receiver by far. I had about five or six scholarship offers to play receiver and was actually committed to Colorado to play receiver for about 2 weeks. But of all the schools, you know, Oregon kind of came in there through Midway and said, "Hey, we might take you as an athlete slash safety linebacker if you end up coming here." So at the time I thought, oh, you know, I'm all CIF league MVP as receiver. I can go to these other places and play receiver. Oregon, you're not going to change my position. I'm too good at that position for you to change it. And it really came down to my uncle and my family in general sitting me down and going, "Hey, would you rather be a receiver in the Big 12 at that time or, you know, a linebacker safety in the Pac-12? And that really took that to heart. And I thought, you know, maybe I'll go up there, maybe they'll see my hands and maybe won't change me. But lo and behold, that first year I was up there, I made the switch to linebacker.
Right. And did you have any, like, did you just play receiver in high school or did you have any, like, both sides of the ball in high school? Because I know a lot of people these days play both sides in high school.
Yeah, so I played both sides. I was like a down safety, strong safety. So mainly playing on the edge and whatnot. And, you know, just back then, the best players usually did go two ways. Like, it wasn't really like one side of the ball. And the game that Oregon came to recruit me, I was playing against a wing T offense. We were playing against, I believe it was Torrance at that time. They ran, you know, these big Samoan dudes that ran wing T offenses and, you know, they were brutal, but I had like 14 tackles that game, setting the edge and kind of condensing the play on my side, shedding tackles and whatnot. And off of that one game that Oregon came to, it came to two games, but that one game really put it in their minds that I could play defense. So, yeah.
Right. And then what was that time at Oregon like building connections with players and really learning a lot?
Oregon was great. I like to believe that Oregon was kind of like bubbling, kind of getting out of sort of the middle of the pack during my time here. But when my class got there and obviously the subsequent classes after that, it really felt like we kind of put it on a national map. You know, for the most part, guys were being recruited primarily from the West Coast. But literally every year after that, you know, from 2006 on, it felt like we were going more national. So making connections with those players, with my teammates back then, like I still talk to a bunch of those guys still to today. And, you know, I always say this to young athletes that are looking to play at the college level is go somewhere that's nowhere near home. You know, my mom told me growing up, she said, hey, you have to go either a 2-hour flight or a 4-hour drive away from home. Now, I'm a city kid. I'm from Los Angeles. So, and I was also in high school during, you know, the Reggie Bush, Matt Leinart years of USC. So I always told my mom, if USC comes calling, like, I'm going to SC down the street. And she said, no, you're not. So, you know, luckily, Oregon was ranked, I believe, at the time. They were like a top 10 team in the country. They had beaten Adrian Peterson in the Holiday Bowl in Oklahoma in the Holiday Bowl. And I was like, this is the highest ranked school. They want me. I'm going to go here. It's away from home. Kind of checked all the boxes for my mom and my family. And it was one of the best decisions I ever made.
Right. And how do you think playing in college and doing all that stuff kind of helped you get ready to go to the pro level?
Well, I think it allowed me playing college and transitioning to the NFL. I think it allowed me to, you know, when you're in college, you're kind of by yourself. It's the first time in your life where you can understand like the early makings of being an adult. Yes, you're still in a controlled environment and your schedule's packed out from essentially, you know, 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. at night. So it really taught me time management. It really taught me how to, you know, kind of be a young man, a young adult, and moving about knowing that I have the right skills, I was raised right, and I know that no matter where I would have went in the NFL, I could have did something, you know, admirable, whether that's special teams and or other. So for me, it was just doing those things to be able to, oh wait, one second. Oh, sorry. The mailman. It was doing those things at a young age to set me up for going across the country, like going to New York as a 22-year-old rookie, not knowing anybody or myself never have been to New York trying to make a team. I knew the skill set that I learned at Oregon and how I was raised, I knew I'd be able to fit in anywhere.
Right. And how do you think, you said your mom said you had to go somewhere 4 hours away from home. How do you think being away from people and kind of changing environments, moving around, helped you be able to get to the pros and be able to go to whatever team drafted you and move team to team?
Yeah, I think when you leave home from high school to college, and again, go somewhere that's not even like even in the state that you're living in, it just allows you to grow and expand in different ways that you can't if you stay local. To like the small things where you come back every couple months or so, you notice that tree down the street is bigger, or that house that used to be yellow is now white. It allows you to kind of step outside of your environment, you know, take in a different environment and come back and kind of compare. So for me, I think that at that young age, and even younger than that, going from my elementary middle school to Beverly Hills High School, which was across the city, that was like a precursor to my time at Oregon and then my time in New York in the NFL, where I felt comfortable being myself in these different landscapes.
Right. And then yourself, you were undrafted. You had to fight for a roster spot to be on the team, to make the team, to get an opportunity. How did do you think that took a toll on you mentally? And how do you think you prepared for that?
Well, yeah, I mean, fighting for a roster spot in the NFL, it's going to take a toll on anybody. Like the dog days of fall camp, I don't think people really understand how taxing and draining it can be. Now, you try to make it fun and whatnot, but for those 3.5 weeks or so, your mind is locked out of the rest of the world. Your only job is to try to land that 1 of 53 roster spots. Now, for me, I kind of sort of rigged the system a little bit. It was interesting because I was looking around, and mind you, this is when Eli Manning, and this is before Victor Cruz became Victor Cruz. I was there the year he became Victor Cruz. You know, the Antrell Rolls and OCU Mayors, like it was those type of teams of the Giants that were always in playoff contention, you know, had beaten the Patriots once before. And I'm looking around as a rookie, and I'm like, well, I'm not in competition with the Elis of the world and the OCs of the world. I'm in competition with the third string running back, the third string DN, the, you know, the bigger safety, the positions that are primarily filled on special teams. And for me, being at Oregon during the Chip Kelly era, Chip always had a rule that if you were a starter on offensive defense, you had to start at least one or two special teams. So I saw on that first week how our special teams coach was just trying his hardest to get these veterans to do the special teams drill right. And I went to his office after that day and was like, hey, you know, the stuff that you're trying to get them to do, like, I can do in my sleep. I did it as an Oregon Duck for 4 years. So a few days later, he gave me a shot to run with the ones in all the special teams, and quickly became one of the best special teams players during my time there. So just not looking at the whole roster as if I'm in competition with all of them helped my mental health, where I was able to compartmentalize and say I'm only in competition with maybe 10 or 12 guys on this team, not the entire 53.
Right. I mean, that's kind of like when you're in math class in middle school and you just want to get out of there, and you break it up into like 5 minute intervals of four or five minute intervals, and you're like, just got to get through the next 5 minutes, the next 5 minutes, just got to beat this one more guy, and then the next guy. And then I'm not even worried about the homework that I have to do later. I just want to get pet. I'm not worried about these Eli Mannings, which is the homework. You're just like, I got to beat these 5 minutes.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you kind of like rig the system a little bit. You gamify the system to make it, you take this big grand idea and try to whittle it down into small ideas that you can then just attain. So, you know, it definitely took a toll on my mental health, but what came from that is, you know, my first off day, I went to the movies, and I ended up realizing like, oh, going to the movies every off day is part of my own mental health to kind of forget about learning 20 new defenses a day, the stress that comes with just being at the facility and always presenting yourself as capable. Every off day for 7 years, I went to the movies. So I quickly became sort of a film critic within the locker room.
Right. And that's just one of the stuff that like keeps you around too, is go to the movies. You can talk about movies. You can talk about other stuff, which keeps you around, makes you a better person. How do you think leadership and being a good teammate helped you stay around? And what do you think that brings to a football team?
Yeah, I mean, I think what that brings to the football team is every football team needs, you know, those 3 to 5 glue guys that they may not make the big play every single weekend. You're not really relying on them to be a game changer, but those are the guys that you can put in any situation and know that they're going to do their job. Now, there's a lot of players that will look at that position and go, I'm better than that. I want to be the $100 million guy. I'm looking to be the face of the team. But because there's so little of those positions all around the league, I found comfort in knowing I'm not the $100 million guy, but I can play all three linebacker positions well enough to where if they put me in that position, they're not going to worry about if I can do it or not. You know, one of the greatest compliments I got from one of my coaches in the league was when we were doing exit meetings, we had just got bumped for the playoffs. And he said, you know what? I wish I spent more time with you, but unfortunately I had to deal with the other guys. And what he was saying is I was never a problem off the field. I always knew my assignment. He never had to overcoach me on something. And it was me going, yeah, coach, like, I'm an adult. I'm a professional athlete. Like, you tell me my job, I'm going to do it. You don't have to worry about me being sort of a hole in the boat, if you know what I mean. So I think every team has those guys, whether those guys know that they're those guys or not. But the guys that take pride in being the glue guy, the guy that can be in multiple positions, the guy that can like speak up in a team meeting every now and then, but then also know how to follow. You can be in this league for a very long time if you're able to like find your flow in that space.
Right. It's the stuff that takes no talent. It's listening the first time, doing it right, not complaining about it, being on time, like just listening and being present and not creating extra drama that keeps you around. Because if we're being honest, maybe someone's just a tad better than you, but they have off-field history that they don't want that person on their team. But then there's you who's been perfect off the field and just wants to be on the team and play and work their ass off. Then they're probably going to take the guy who's a better person.
Oh, absolutely. And I'll be the first to tell you, I was never the biggest, the strongest, the fastest, the toughest, the best tackler. I would never say I was better than anybody in those categories, but what I will always, you know, champion is the fact that coaches never have had to worry about me being a liability in the position that they put me in. I always knew exactly what I needed to do. And if I didn't, I made up with it with hustle. So I was a guy that coaches just didn't have to worry about because they always knew I knew my job.
Right. And I mean, me personally, baseball, first ever travel baseball team I ever tried out for, 10U. These guys probably played for 1 or 2 years under this guy for eight-year-olds, 9U. 10-year-old, I come in there. No one ever knows who I was, but I hustled. I think I picked up the most balls out of everybody when we were picking up balls in the cage. We were doing all that stuff, and I think that's majority of the reason I made the team. I mean, I wasn't the tallest guy there. I wasn't the best hitter. I wasn't the hardest thrower, but I hustled and I did stuff. I mean, if that's gonna what it takes, I mean, why not do it?
Yeah, yeah. Like I said, coaches spend 90% of their time on 10% of the players. And I believe it's your job and every athlete's out there job is to not be part of that 10%. So, yeah.
Right. And it's not having the coach be on your ass all day and being like, you missed the fly ball. You got to run around the field three times or something like that. Like, yeah, you don't need a coach telling you to go to the field and get extra work in or do all that stuff. How about you do it by yourself, which will eventually make yourself a better player.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that, again, that comes with even socially, that's being just as disciplined as you are on the field, off the field. You know, I've said no to a lot of different opportunities, whether it's partying, drinking and all that type of stuff, because I knew it would not make me the best that I can be at my job the next day. So, yeah, even with some of my friends that are that are my age now that I kind of came up with, they might have these like great war stories of going out and hanging out and having these wild times and stuff. And I'm there for some of them, but for the most part, I'm listening to them as if I've never heard it before, because I was probably studying my playbook or in the house trying to stay out of trouble, just because I knew whatever they were doing was probably not conducive to where I was trying to go.
Right. And then another thing, more of the fun time in the NFL, is what was the biggest hit you saw on the field?
The biggest hit I saw on the field, oh man. So I'll go back to college on this one. Still one of the greatest hits I've ever seen live. And I remember seeing, because I was 2 feet away, and I actually joked because safety TJ Ward, who's still a friend of mine to this day, and had a great long Super Bowl winning career in the NFL, we were at Oregon together. We were playing in the Holiday Bowl against Dez Bryant and Oklahoma State. And their quarterback ended up scrambling, tried to run for a first down. And me and one or two other Ducks were in hot pursuit. And all of a sudden, TJ Ward comes from like, you know, 15 yards away, clearing that space in a second, and literally folds him in half. And if you look at that film, it's the 2008 Holiday Bowl. I truly believe that the quarterback was like knocked unconscious for like half a second and then realized it and popped back up. But still one of the hardest hits, and TJ Ward's still one of the hardest hitters, consistently hardest hitters I've ever had the privilege of playing for. So yeah, I'll go back to college on that one.
And then what was the ugliest uniforms you've played against or wore?
The ugliest uniforms I've played against or wore. Oh man, that's a tough one. Ugliest uniforms. You might be stumping me with this one. I will say, seeing the New York Giants wearing white pants now makes me hate the fact that they forced us to wear gray pants all those years. And I think we might have worn them one time when I was there, I believe. And everybody was like, why are we not wearing white pants from here on out? And finally they made the switch. It's just cleaner. But I'll go with that. I just hated the Giants gray pants.
Right. And then obviously one of your cooler experiences that you got to experience your first year in the league, making the team, doing all that stuff, like grinding the hardest you probably ever worked in your career, your first year in the pros, you get rewarded to go to the Super Bowl. What was that experience like?
Oh, it was, I mean, honestly, this 12, 13 years later, I'm still trying to like understand exactly what that moment meant, because You gotta. I'll take you back for a bit. Please mind me. You know, we end up going to the Super Bowl. We were in playoff mode by, you know, week 14 of that season. You know, we were 9-7 going into the playoffs, a wild card team. We had an infamous sort of like no win November, we called it, where we started, I believe, 6-2, very hot going into our bye week. But then entering November, we like didn't win a game. I think we lost like 5 out of 6 games. And it got to the point, it had to have been around week 13 or 14, where we said, if we don't win out, it's likely we are not going to the playoffs. And you walk around the Giants facility, especially when Eli was there, it was just get 10 to the playoffs. That was the mantra, get 10 to the playoffs. Because you knew once Eli got to the playoffs, he was just a different person. And so we're in playoff mode very early. We're running through all the different teams. And we get to the Super Bowl. The confetti starts flying on that last throw. Gronk comes within like a half a foot of catching the ball after it was deflected in the end zone. I'm running around the field. I see my dad and my brother get onto the field way too fast. I think they might like hop the gate or something. And I see them and I just start bawling because literally a year prior to that, I lost the national championship against Cam Newton and the Auburn Tigers. So from going within the course of 13 months, going from losing a national championship to winning a Super Bowl, knowing everything I had been through to get to that point, going undrafted and making the team and being injured a couple different times throughout the season, it just all like cascaded out of me after winning that Super Bowl. So it was funny because me and my roommate, rest in peace, Tyler Sash, we were jokingly like entering the playoffs. You know, we're 9-17. We're going against the Falcons and Green Bay and the 49ers, all on paper were like way better teams than us. And we like packed up our apartment like a month early. And we just kept extending an extra week because we were like, all right, we might win this week. So let's just break the lease and do it. Oh, we might win this week. Oh, we might win this week. And we ended up winning the Super Bowl. And jokingly, we were like, that was easy. We might as well just do this again next year. And I mean, I say that now, but it was I only made it to the playoffs one other time in my 7-year career. So I'm happy I got it the first time.
And then moving on past your playing career, when did you kind of know it was time to hang up the cleats and retire?
Yeah, it's a couple different energies like all sort of came together at one point. It was around 2015 where, again, rest in peace, Tyler Sash. Tyler Sash passed away during an accidental drug overdose. Literally went to sleep with some medication that he was taking. And apparently that, from what I know, it became toxic in his body over a certain amount of time. It passed away in his sleep. So hearing his family, hearing his mother pretty much like telling me like, you know, walk away from the game. It took my son, don't let it take you. That was absolutely one of the defining factors of starting to chart my path out of the NFL. But then also just the idea of, and you'll come to understand this when you get older, but the NFL really just became a job for me after a while. It was something that I woke up, I went to do, I clocked in and I clocked out. And from somebody, I was always somebody that, you know, dove into my interests off the field. So I was doing internships and job shadowing experiences and just meeting people in the world that were doing cool and interesting things that I thought I might want to do. And I really got to understand that the world was just a lot bigger than what, you know, we like to believe sports offers. A lot of coaches out there tell you, you know, this is the brightest your life will ever be. The lights will never be as bright as now and whatnot. And I just never really believed that. I believe that I can have a long career and then walk away at the ripe age of 29, 30 years old and still have hopefully two thirds of my life to live. And one of the tight ends for the Jets, a guy named Kellen Davis, it was like year 5 for me at this point. I was just trying to understand, do other players think this way? Does any other player kind of get that itch? And unfortunately, I was talking to a lot of different players and all of them thought I was crazy for like wanting to walk away from the NFL at the time that I wanted to. And, you know, Kellen Davis, who was a friend of mine during my time at the Giants, we were on the team together. We played against each other in London. It was when I was on the Dolphins and he was just like, oh, you're getting that scratch, huh? You're getting that itch. play two more years, and if you want to retire, then retire. But just within these 2 years, try to set yourself up for something off the field. And around that time is when All-American started becoming more and more real. Just the idea of screenwriting and learning this world. So for that two-year window, I was just doing anything I could to meet people in the TV and film industry to the point where I was able to retire and kind of seamlessly transition into this space.
Right. And speaking of All-American, like you just said, how did that kind of come about?
So it happened like fast by all metrics. But in my head, it just felt like things were going kind of slow. So it started with me going and watching movies every Tuesday, NFL off days. It's the Tuesday. And it's got to the point where I was like, hey, I think I could like write some of this stuff. I'm noticing what's happening in film before it's happening. So like, let me see if I can write it. So for years, like I'm talking 2 or 3 years, I was just writing short stories under just learning the art of screenwriting. I sent a few stories to a friend of mine who's his roommate out in Los Angeles sold in the unscripted space. So unscripted TV is like game shows, travel shows, Love Island, those types of shows. And he was like, hey, like this stuff is kind of good, but you know, why are you doing this? And during my sixth year playing, I came to their apartment on my bye week, and we just started chopping up about being from Los Angeles and both playing, knowing different people in Los Angeles and just football culture in Los Angeles and what does it mean to be from LA, but there's like 20 different communities plus in this city. And we didn't realize it, but we were starting to think about the early bones of what All-American became. So I went back to playing. A couple weeks later, he called me and said, hey, I had this random conversation with this pretty big TV producer. I told him about you. He asked, can you write him something to like kind of talk about your life? And by that point, I kind of knew how to take you through the ebbs and flows of storytelling. And I wrote like a one-page something, sent it off to him. And a few weeks later, I ended up meeting with them, just talking to them about my life, growing up in South Central, but going to Beverly Hills High School and what that did and didn't do for me. And they loved it when we went to contract negotiations like 2 weeks later. So yeah, it's kind of like the fast version of it. But my last sort of year and a half playing, we were simultaneously developing All-American.
Right. And that answers what one of my next questions was going to be is, you retired 2017, 2018, the show comes out. And like, as you said, behind the scenes, you worked on it before you retired. And then it got produced, obviously, and got shown. And now it's one of the largest TV shows out there.
Mm-hmm.
And then another thing with that is, obviously, the show's about you. You kind of helped produce it. What is the behind the scenes of producing a TV show? Like, not necessarily writing it, but yeah, filming it.
Yeah, I mean, so I retired, I technically retired December 27th, 2017. By April 2018, we were shooting the pilot. So it quickly went from walking away from a dream that I had spent arguably 20 years trying to get to 4 months later being like streamlined into another dream that I was attempting to like manifest. And the word producing or producer, I would say, it took me over a year to truly understand what that word meant, because a producer, I've distilled it down to like a producer brings resources to a project, whether that's money, whether that's talent, whether that's location, craft services, anything like that. You can essentially consider yourself a producer. So in producing the show, it's the studio will give you a budget. You have to stay underneath that budget by all means. Now it's your job to go out and find the actors that might be interested in playing these roles, hiring people to find the locations, to write the scripts. We have an awesome team of writers over the years, somewhat up to about 10 different writers throughout each season that craft these stories. So whenever somebody says like, thank you for writing All-American, I immediately throw all the praise to the writers room, because they are the professionals that I've written on the show before, but they are the professionals that like lend their heart and soul to the show to make it what it is. But it's really just, you know, 100+ people in front and behind the camera collectively that are all doing their one thing, kind of like a football team, to will the show into existence. So, you know, we're starting to film season 7 in about 2 weeks from now. And it's just really, this time of year is always fun because it's not like we have exactly what we want the story to be at the end of each season for the next season. We get to literally create a new season every time we're off. So it's just been, it's always a really special time, the time that we're in when it comes to producing a TV show.
Right. And it was originally based off of your life, what you did, but it doesn't necessarily need to follow the exact borders of what you did and that stuff. You can go off a little because it's not my life, the story of Spencer Paysinger. It's all American. Who cares? No one's going to know if you play, if bigger picture, if you play out right side linebacker or left side or weak, strong side or weak side, no one's going to care about that if you do that, or if you wore number 50 instead of 48. Like, yeah, just small stuff there that could change it.
Yeah, and that's why we say it's inspired by. I think on one hand, I never wanted to tell the exact story of my upbringing because honestly, like, I don't remember.
That's a little invasion of your, like, I wouldn't feel comfortable giving, like, most details about my life.
Yeah, and with that, you also don't want people from your past coming up and going, that's not true, that's not what happened, I was there. So on the other side of it, Spencer James, you know, and this is what I came to learn and appreciate with the show, is Spencer James was way bigger than Spencer Paysinger's history. Spencer James had to sort of, at the time that we were developing it, mind you, this is like, we started developing it in like 2017, to like late 2016, 2017, premiered in 2018. You know, that was a very different time in America that a lot of stuff that's happening now kind of not started then, but like came to a boiling point. Tipping point around then, and we really wanted to make Spencer James sort of stand for the, you know, teen experience in America at that moment in time. You know, he's somebody that, you know, he attempts to put too much on his shoulders. He deals with his own like mental health issues. He has friends in all these various places around Los Angeles, and he's trying to figure out, you know, where does he fit within that. He's trying to save his family from, you know, his hometown, although he loves his hometown. So we wanted to show this sort of beautifully conflicted teenage experience that I believe we were able to over the course of 6 seasons.
Right, and then what lessons did you learn from playing on the football field, facing adversity, and then writing a TV show?
I think the fact that in sports, you can withstand a lot. I've played in freezing temperatures. I've played in boiling temperatures. I've been cursed out by coaches. I've had injuries that, you know, have caused limbs to go numb for weeks on end. Getting a no from the industry doesn't even register on a bad day for me, you know? So imagine you're in an air-conditioned room on a Zoom pitching a TV series and, you know, the executive tells you, thanks, but no thanks, we don't like this idea. In my head, I'm like, okay, that's fine. Can you give me a reason so I can make my project better? I don't spend my time wallowing in no's. I think football has taught me that I can take a lot on the chin and still keep pushing. And yeah, just from the coaches that I've had, from the players and the relationships I had, I know I'm a team player. I know that I can be a team player with anybody as long as they are also trying to reach that collective goal. And one thing that I did learn in this industry is that a lot of people that are in this industry didn't kind of grow up that way. So it can be a little bit doggy dog out here. And, you know, a lot of people just don't understand that if we can all work together, we can all get to that collective goal together, it makes all of us look better. There's a lot of people out here that attempt to, whether it's stealing ideas or taking the shine away from the collective group to kind of put it on themselves. But I've realized that I have seen that before. I'm going to see it again. This is not something that's going to deter me from being in and of this industry.
Right. And football, as you said, you all work together. You all get to say Super Bowl champion at the end of the year. You're part of that team. It wouldn't happen if Eli was like, oh, I need to throw for 5,000 passing yards and 50 touchdowns, and that's all I care about. No, he wanted to win for the team, and then at the end of the day, you guys all get to celebrate and win a Super Bowl. I mean, for producing, if one person just wants to do them for themselves, it's not going to work as they think it will for themselves. I mean, doing stuff as a team benefits, which definitely is a lesson that I, from what you said, taught you well. And then just facing adversity in sports. I mean, quarterbacks nowadays, they'll throw an interception. Yes, they'll slam their helmet maybe, but then they'll get over it right away, go back to the tablet, realize why that wasn't open, but then they won't make that mistake necessarily again. Like in TV, that's, you, as you said, getting you'll go back and you'll fix it, you'll revise it. Some people would just give up at that point, which isn't going to make a successful person.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And then what was your original plan with All-American, with TV shows, when you first got into it to now?
Well, initially when we started, like me and my producing partner, Danny Mork, when we were initially brainstorming what this could be, especially with Greg Berlanti and the studio, between me and him, we were like, oh, this could be like a grittier version of network sports show, teen drama. You know, me and my producer partner have a vast history in college and high school sports. So we knew we would be able to tell a like hyper-focused POV of this life. You know, what we were pleased to be wrong about was the fact that putting it on network TV and putting it through sort of the machine that we put it through, we were able to touch way more people than attempting to be the somewhat salacious, somewhat, you know, cutting edge football series, to be hyper specific of it. I think for me, I was learning this industry with a TV show on the air, and I just didn't know what I didn't know back then. So, you know, I was pitching it one way to this company, but then, you know, talking to my friends about it being something else to this company, and not really knowing what was the best story that would service the most people. So it was definitely a grittier story starting out, but I think we made the right decision in taking it the route that it currently went, because I feel like it had the most impact.
Right, and that impact on people, your legacy, obviously, people will say a name and right to your mind. You could say any person you know, any name, and something about them will pop right to your mind. What do you want that necessarily to be when someone hears Spencer Paysinger? What's your legacy you want to leave on people?
I think my legacy that if you just heard my name and that first thing pops in your head, I would want it to be he could adapt to anything. I've shown adaptability since I was a kid. I've shown to be able to be kind of dropped off in the wilderness, in the ocean, and find my way back. Just because I always believe that I have a strong moral compass. I don't tend to allow myself to go off the scale in any aspect of that. So whether it be transitioning from a predominantly Black school to a predominantly white school, whether it's transitioning to another state, across the country, fighting for a job on a team, transitioning out of the NFL, getting a show on the air, selling a film, doing other TV shows and whatnot, kind of wading the waters through this industry today, which is, you know, kind of in a depression, I've been able to adapt in a great way. So if you think about me, I would just say that's a guy that knows how to adapt.
All right. To end it off here, we got the final 14 questions in a rapid fire pace.
Oh, all right. Here we go.
All right. Who is your idol?
My brother, older brother, Justin Paysinger.
Favorite fast food place?
In-N-Out.
Biggest fear?
Spiders.
Favorite school subject?
Egyptian history.
Favorite hobby?
Movies.
Favorite gym workout?
Burpees.
Favorite animal?
Ooh, elephant.
Favorite influencer?
Influencer. I like, he's not an influencer, Charlamagne the God.
Favorite movie?
Depends on season and mood, but for right now, I will go with American Gangster.
Biggest pet peeve?
Biggest pet peeve. Not keeping your word.
Favorite emoji?
This emoji with the hands up.
Is the hot dog a sandwich?
Yes.
And then last but not least, are you a shower singer?
Of course.
That was a really, really good one. Really good 5-14 right there.
Oh, that's dope. That's dope.
Yeah, that was really good. For most people, they're like, well, like you were boom, 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 which was really good.
I know. It's rapid fire. I want to keep waiting.
Yeah. Thank you once again.